Hello there. Once again, it's Anton from Anton Obey. Thank you for stopping by the collection room today. Today I'm looking at some more issues of Femforce from AC Comics. This is issues 17 through 20. And if you watched the last episode of this where I did Femforce Comics, you'll know that we switched from color to black and white print inside with issue 16. It was just something they weren't able to apparently sustain at the time with cost. But it wasn't going to stop them from producing books. And that's kind of a theme with Femforce is no matter what, no matter what changes they made, they just kept producing books. So it's a quality that I appreciated from the company. I also really appreciate that they never changed their format. They never tried to update with the times. These things were what was working. That's what still works. That's what they still make. So anyway, we're starting off with issue 17 here. And like I said, we're going straight into a black and white book, which is a little bit sad. Some of this art, I mean, I love a black and white comic. Don't get me wrong. I don't have any prejudice against it. But some of these art, some of these pencils, this is Darren Hartgood. Goodhart. He's done, quite a bit of these books and he does a fantastic job. And it's just a shame that, you know, you don't get to see these images in color because they're really, really well done. The art is fantastic. And I mean, like this page, for instance, it's a great page. It's a big splash page. You've got a lot of black. You've got a lot of stars. You've got a lot of stuff going on. It just would be something amazing to see in color. And so there is a little bit of sadness that we don't get these in color. But it is what it is. It's better to have them in black and white than to not have them at all. That's the kind of stuff that they did. They kept things rolling. Looks like we get the character Thunder Fox popping up. The Femforce Portfolio, Volume 2. And that's a nice splash page. I'll put this down a few blocks away. I'll be right back. Leave it on the pier, throw it in for that matter. Yeah, that's kind of funny. It's a Chrysler too. They even drew the hood ornament so you can know the brand. That's kind of funny. Most of the time they leave those out. They left that in this one, but it's a good splash page. Leave it on the banks of the city hall. Yeah, so it's just a matter of, man, this would be great in color, but we have it in what we have it. Looks like he's redesigning Rad. Got any bottoms? Nope, shirts only. No bottoms. Artistic reference. Huh. Man, some of the one-liners you read in this book always crack me up. Yeah, some of this, oh man, it's been a while since I read it, so it's kind of hard for me, like, I can't remember what's going on, actually, some of the times. And you know what, even sometimes if it's a book that I really remember well, and I'm like, oh yeah, this is what's going on. My goal is not to, like, spare you the time of reading the comic. I'm not flipping through it so you don't have to read it. I just want you to see what's inside some of these books. And it's not like I'm trying to save you time and money. Here, check out this comic. This is that's what you would have read. No, it's more a matter of, I want you to see what's out there. Take a look inside some of these books. Because sometimes we see these covers and we don't look what's inside. And as a comic book guy, I am guilty of that. We buy stuff for the cover, for the art. We don't ever get to the stories. And a lot of times, we don't even see what's inside. And I think that that's something that a lot of modern comic companies are capitalizing on. Because I see covers that are more and more fantastic. Like, really well done. but the insides are, like, the art is really subpar. Like, this stuff, this is really good. Somebody took time on it. There's effort put into it. This is a great page. They're all chewing her out because she appeared in a, or because some of them appeared in a men's magazine without their permission. They're pretty upset about it. It's a funny issue. I do remember that. Oh goodness. If that's not supposed to be Betty Page, I don't know who is. That's clearly her. Got the bangs, the whole scenario, fighting for the camera. That's totally a Betty Page homage there. But yeah, just appreciating what's inside these books. Something I think a lot of modern cover collectors, I should say, don't really do. Not that I'm bagging on cover collectors, because I mean, there's plenty of comics I've got just for the cover. But most of the time in the olden days, they had a fairly adequate art inside to back it up. And I know this last year I picked up a lot of new books out of dollar bins and stuff, and was sorely disappointed by the contents inside. They looked awful. Just picking them up and looking at them. There wasn't a lot going on inside. There's so much going on inside. It's good. Yeah, the only sad part that keeps getting me is, like, how great this art was and how sad it is that we don't get any color to it. And this issue of Buffy, our ace photographer, goes inside Stella Stargaze. Stella Stargaze is also, the Stargazers. If you've ever seen the Stargazers comics, pretty sure that's the same Stargazer. So that's pretty cool. Florida's favorite television temptress. As it is. Ads for She-Cat. Ads for Cave Girl, which is nice reprinting of classic stuff. And we get a Cave Girl story even in the midst of it. And it's black and white, but I'm pretty sure, I'm trying to think if Cave Girl was originally color. Might have been. But these guys could reprint these stories, pop them in the back of your issue, get you more bang for your buck without having to laboriously produce another story. That's cool. Just on the back. I'm not sure who that is. But they just threw that in there for us. So probably has something to do with the old comic in the back. Because this is definitely pre-80s. Anyway. And this is, let's see, what year have we moved on to? 89 at this point. So we're almost in the 90s. Yeah, giving you more bang for your buck without maybe, reprinting some stuff that they got from Fiction House was not a bad idea. That's a tremendous cover shot there. The art is a little bit weird. Like, that doesn't look like maybe their normal artist guy. With Tara fighting some snakes. I don't know if it's going to show us who the... it's a snake-headed woman. Yikes. Pencils, Greg Horn. I was like, yeah, I'm not really recognizing this. It looks a little bit off. Usually it all looks really pretty uniform. Even when they have different artists, it's almost as if they had this distinct art style for their books. And like I said before, there's no way Barry Windsor Smith could draw for this book. Just the way he draws stuff, it wouldn't work. Like, nope, not going to happen. So there is a certain art style that lends itself to the Femme Force comics. Not overly musculature, not... sinewy or rigid. There is a softness to all the characters, especially the women, because it is good girl art. It's not bad girl art. Bad girl art, you could draw some more muscle definition and make them a little scarier, but that's not the intent here with this art. So, man, I think that's another Chrysler. It really, is that Chrysler or is that Cadillac? That might be Cadillac. That's definitely a Mercedes. It's funny that they're actually drawing on the emblems, because a lot of companies, I don't think, will even draw like the Ford oval. Like, you can't even have an oval on the front. It's funny that they got away with putting in all the actual car manufacturers in here. I wonder if they had to ask for permission, or if just nobody noticed. Perils of the Darkest Jungle, 12 episodes. That's cool. Night Vale meets the Avenger. He does look like an Avenger. Not our Avengers, but American comics Avengers. I like his little quad jet thing, quad airplane thing. That's pretty cool. Yeah, he's really reminding me of the Flash, actually, in his design. Can't say as I'm in love with it, but it is what it is. Laura, you're my sister, Laura. As if he wouldn't know. I always love seeing all the cereals that they advertise in the back. And by cereal, I don't mean food. I mean actual, like, shows, cereals. On to issue 20. This guy is so ghastly. You of course see him in the first issues. He comes out then, and he is a long-term reoccurring villain for the thing. You are officially invited to the 20th anniversary of Femforce Magazine, September 1989. Was it 20th anniversary? Really? How? How was it the 20th issue? Or 20th anniversary? It's 1989. I want to say the Femforce RPG game was from like the 70s, so it can't be 20 year anniversary yet. That seems a little odd. I'll have to figure out how they're counting that. Whole room full of superheroes. That's always a good thing. Oof, something way crazy with the art right down there. It got way off for a second, just in faces. Time for the ceremony. That's an interesting double shot page there. I'm not familiar, who is that? I'm not positive, that must be like Valkyrie or something. Huh. I don't know. I actually can't tell who that is. But we'll continue on. Okay, sometimes I think her hands are gross. I always have trouble. Her name is She-Cat. But I always have troubles remembering this name. Because there's Black Cat, Cat Claw, Cat Woman. I know there's more, but I get a slightly blended with all my cat themed heroines and villains, because there is a slew of them, cat ladies. Just a big, big popular genre there, I guess. I know, you'd think of it like She-Hulk, but there was also the Jaguar. That was another cat-themed hero. And that's from... I actually really appreciate that book. It's a good comic. I think it was Impact? Yeah, Impact Comics did Jaguar. Eternity Comics did Cat Claw. These are all comics that I focus on pretty heavily because they're... they're just interesting to me. Plus, there's the Cheetah, Cheetara's from Thundercats. There's, I think it's the Cheetah. No, the Cheetah's from DC. Crap, there's one from Heroic Graphics, too, that is a cat-themed woman. I don't know, the Cheetah or it's not Cheetara. Shoot, I can't remember. Gosh, now I'm all confused because there's just too many cat-themed characters. Not trying to get lost. but I inadvertently got lost because I cannot keep all of the cat characters straight. There's so many. So many. Got it. Gotta get them all. The Untold Origins of Femme Force, issue number one. Pretty sure I have that too. Anyway, maybe not quite as beautiful as some of the color ones, but that is what they are. I do love this red cover here. This was not the last, but one of the last issues I was able to obtain. So that was a little bit harder to get. Anyway, that's your Femme Force for the day. Thank you so much for watching. I appreciate it. You guys are great. That's my story. Catch you guys later. Bye.